or things are exonerated, Abi Musa al-Ash'ari. If they were confirmed, then Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman would not have permitted himself to simply to give the indication that Abi Musa al-Ash'ari was a hypocrite. When he said, if you were among those hypocrites, if you were among them, even if you to look at that as just simply as raising doubt, opening the way to accuse someone. Hudhayfa's method, actually, as historians have said, is wasn't such a way that he would place doubt or allow doubt to be placed upon certain people accused of hypocrisy. If Abi Musa al-Ash'ari truly was, according to your claims and attempts, believer because of the things you've mentioned, then Hudhayfa would not have dared to do something that places doubt upon the belief of that person and indicates his hypocrisy. Based on either interpretation, either he placed doubt or declared Abi Musa al-Ash'ari hypocrite. Either way, the answer is these claims have no place in reality, these attempts to defend Abi Musa al-Ash'ari. And if they were, then they do not actually exonerate and defend Abi Musa al-Ash'ari against the accusation of hypocrisy. At any rate, using the seerah of the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him and his family, as evidence that used to say that he treated these people well, does not mean that the Messenger of Allah saw them as believers, true followers, and that they could not be hypocrites. And this narration, Nabi Shayba, continues to be a thorn in the side of everyone who is trying to exonerate Abi Musa al-Ash'ari of the accusation of hypocrisy. And as we've said earlier, all their attempts have failed. All those who attempted to refute this narration, whether it's the content, the chain of transmission, so on and so forth, none of it holds up to reality. The last of those attempts was Abi Musa al-Ash'ari. His name was put in this narration by mistake. I was the last week, or I said in the last week, I tried to look at find the original copies of Musannaf ibn Abi Shayba, just so that I can confirm that the original sources contained the name of Abi Musa al-Ash'ari in that handwritten copies. And I was not able to do so. And in all honesty, I don't have that expertise in the world of the internet so that I can reach these sources. Then my office informed me that someone who heard my statements last week, a brother, went and looked online and found very valuable original handwritten copies that show the name of Abi Musa al-Ash'ari specifically in this narration, for this narration, which does not leave room for anyone to claim that Abi Musa al-Ash'ari's name was inserted here by mistake, or that the original wording of the narration did not include his name. I ask that you kindly, if you could show these original copies live, so we can discuss it further. And we wish to thank the person who found these copies for us. So, as you can see, it's Musannaf ibn Abi Shayba by the library of from the library, Father Ahmed Basha in Turkey. And what's seen on the screen is the 9th volume of Musannaf ibn Abi Shaybah. And you can see it in its pages, the name of Abi Musa al-Ash'ari, the narration. And then last, in this page actually, in the at the end of the page, let's see why in red, what happened in Laylat al-Aqaba. And then he would mention the narrations regarding that incident. And the second page, if you can you see the number of page? Sometimes in the bottom, I cannot see anything. I cannot see the number of the page. Perhaps on the left says 128. In PDF, I think in the PDF it's 138 in the PDF copy that I have. 183. If you see on the edge, actually, there's a number. If you zoom in, you could see it. It says 128. And the narration we're looking for So at the end of the page 128, so you says Fadl ibn Dukayn said to us, if you could zoom in so we could see better. We see pixels on the screen for some reason while the image is moving. Fadl ibn Dukayn said to us of Walid ibn Jumayh of Abi Tufail said, there was an argument between Hudhayfa and a man who participated in the assassination attempt in Al-Aqaba. And he said, Hudhayfa, the narration says, he said, the next page, how many were those who participated in Al-Aqaba's attempt? People said, he asked you, then why don't you answer? Then Abi Musa al-Ash'ari, and you put the line underneath, we were told they were 14. And Hudhayfa said, if you are among them, then they are 50. I testify to Allah. 12 of them are a war to the Messenger of Allah and his prophet in dunya and the hereafter. And he excused three who said, we did not hear what the Messenger of Allah's caller has said, and we did not know those people attempted the assassination. If you could move the lines and zoom in a bit further, we have a few stops here. So we see the full narration on the screen. So if you can see, it is clear on the screen, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari said, at the same time, pay attention, that this narration says, this copy said, I testify that 12 of them are a war, not a party, not hizb. So where did that dot com on top of the R, change the letter? Could have been a mistake. If you can see, there is something that might look like a dot close to the R, and perhaps those who are typing wrote it Hizb instead of Harb, so that others don't come to us and say, no, the original writing was Hizb, not Harb, which means party, not war.
هنالك كذلك أبله اتصل
There
وقال
was this idiot
بأنه
who called actually and
اللفظ
said
الأصلي
the original
وإن
wording was
كنت فيهم يعني
if
كأن
I was
حذيفة
among
يتكلم
them
عن
as if
نفسه
Hudhayfa was
قال
talking
لأنه
about
هذا
himself
الموجود في ضبط الكلمة
claiming that
وهو
this
معتمد
was
على ماذا على الطبعات المعاصرة شوف
what's
المسألة
written and he's looking at modern
وقلنا له
copies and
هذه
we
لا
said to him
حجة
this
فيها لأنه من
is
الذي
not
ضبط بهذا الضبط
confirmed you can't
هذا
use that as
يرجع
a
إلى
refutation
محفوظات مثلا قديمة
this is based
هذا
on
هذا
old
الذي
copies
تقول له
do you
وإنما
claim
هذا
is it
غاية
is based
ما
on
هنالك
old copies
اجتهاد هذا الطابع الذي طبع
simply
مثلا
the
بهذا الشكل
writer
هذا لا
who
حجة فيه
rewrote the book
أساسا
made a mistake
أخطاء كثيرة
and
نعم
many
نعم
mistakes happen
الآن لاحظوا وإن
as you
كنت
can see
هذه فيها
you
عليها
don't
أي ضمة أو فتحة أو كسرة
nothing
حتى
on
واحد
it
يقول مثلا
كنت
اللفظ الأصلي هو
so you
وإن
can't say
كنت
كنت is the
ويريد
original
أن
term
يلزمنا
and then
بذلك
trying to force that
كلام
on us
سخيف يعني
silly
لاحظوا
things
شيئا
really
آخر أيضا
also there's another thing
أنه أحيانا
to look
قد
at
تضاف
sometimes
نقاط
dots are added
للكلام ولا ينبغي أن تضاف
and
خطأ من
which should not be added
لاحظوا اسم
for example
أبو موسى
أبي
الأشعري
موسى الأشعري
ملاحظين أنه هنالك
you can see there are two dots
أبو موسي
underneath the name of أبي
ما
موسى
نضع
it's like
النقطتين تحت
now
الألف
Arabic now would
مقصورة
sound like
هذه
أبي
ألف
موسي
مقصورة
not أبي موسى
من أين جاءت هاتان
where did
النقطتان
these two dots
خطأ من النسخة
come
يحصل
mistakes can happen
فلا يصح للشخص أنه يتمسك يتشبث بمثل هذه الأمور.
So it's not possible for, or it's not reasonable for a person to look at these things and use them to defend their arguments. Another point here, it says when he said there are three.
وعذر
it says EX use three.
لا يوجد هنالك لا توجد نقطة
you can see
على
there is no dot on, to, on the they or the other places. Where they should exist.
It's
as if
says
he mentioned three. Could have been read like this. Imagine someone come to us out of stubbornness only and say, no, the original term was he counted three with nothing to show for it, no, nothing to prove it. You have to put all the proofs, all reports together.
Ahmed
and Muslim have narrated the same narration, same chain of transmission. And they all agreed that the original term was Harb, a war to the Messenger of Allah and His Lord, and also agreed it was other, not added, excuse, not counted. It's the same, let's say, if you were in Kunta, then there were 15, not as the person tried to attempt saying it was Kuntu, if I was. So if those try to make these very weak arguments, it will just become a laughing stock. Those who come and claim that the original term does not even, or the original wording of the report does not even include the name of Abi Musa al-Ash'ari. You can see them with, see it with your eyes. How old are this copy? I forgot to mention this. Of course, it was
محمد بن عبد الله الطلحاوي 16 صفر سنة
758 هجري
يعني قبل 600 سنة
600 years in the past oh, so close to 700 years
لاحظتوا
ago but now you bring modern copies try to use against us
لا كتب قبل هذا الناسخ
copies before those who written this book it was in the 7th century
لا 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 شيء قديم طيب
at any rate is there another older copy there was another actually 100 years later after this copy that was written 885. This is written by Nur al-Uthmaniyya. This narration is found in this copy in the 7th volume. 883. Apologies, and it is about what happened in the night of Al-Aqaba, the bottom of the page. narration is found here. This is the chapter. Narration is in the narration that comes after, or the page that comes after, in the middle of the page. Fadl ibn Dukayn said to us, of Walid ibn Jumay, of Abi Tufayl, who said, there was an argument between Hudhayfa and those who participated in Al-Aqaba, and he said to him, how many were those who participated in the attempt of Al-Aqaba? Then people said to him, answer, he's asked you a question. Then Abi Musa Al-Ash'ari said, and if you see in this copy, they also put two dots until the name of Abi Musa became Abi Musa. There was habits actually. I've seen the old copies actually. There was probably habit. People's when they're writing, it's just a habit to put two dots when it's actually grammatically incorrect. Some would say it was the way it's read. It wouldn't have been written that way anyway. At any rate, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari said, and here says, you stood. If you look at this, mistake happened. You used to tell them they were there for you. Not that we were told. There were 15. These mistakes happen because they're written by hands. That if you were among them, there were 15. You can see there is no dhamma, or which changes the term become from kunta to kuntu, which changes the meaning of the term from you to me. Then here, actually, continue on. See, there is a dot. So another mistake, inconsistency by the writer. We're told there were 15, and he accused them. And he excused of them. How do you know this? How do we know this? Ahmed and Musa used that term, so we know what he meant. We did not know what the Messenger of Allah, blessings and peace be upon him, say, and we did not know what those people were attempting. And see, at the end says, we did not know what we wanted, instead of saying what they wanted. So you can't really just demean yourself and act so stupid. These, will they be real academic responses to what we are saying? It's really surprising. It's an academic session. It's being held. Someone call and say the name isn't there, and trying to play a game on the screen. Some say no, it was Kuntu. Some would say it Hizb. They're not hypocrites. They're all good. 15 of them, they were good people, because 12 of them are the party of Allah. Those who they are the resistance. And three of them are excused. Well, then where are those who wanted to kill the Messenger of Allah? Where are the hypocrites? The crime belongs to an unknown participant. It is not reasonable to make these arguments. So now it is time to admit. It is necessary for everyone. We must come from this foundation. Allah willing, we'll open the phone calls for people to participate. As long as people don't go back and try to say things that we have completely, utterly refuted. That Abu Musa al-Ash'ari is not there, for example. We've shown that his name is there. Musannaf ibn Abi Shaybah, from 100 years ago, his name exists. If you have copies that does not include his name, and instead say the man said, as we see in what Ahmed has reported and Muslim, then you can make an argument. But to come to us and say, no, the name simply never existed, the original source. If you meant by words like this, that when Ibn Abi Shaybah was relaying or mentioning this narration, and then by mistake added the name of Abu Musa al-Ashari, and the authentic narration was that his name was not there, as Ahmed has narrated, of Fadl ibn Dukayn, same chain of transmission, this is something we have refuted. And we have no problem to discuss it even further and to say what is truth, that Ahmed ibn Hanbal, it was his practice, known practice, when he finds a narration that might be critical to the Messenger of Allah's companions, peace be upon him and his family, that could expose them, he would alter this narration. He inserts things or he would omit things. And we have shown examples of that in the last month of Ramadan series. So that is, that will do you no good. Because that man, Ahmed ibn Hanbal, is accused, so is Muslim, when it comes to making these omissions from narrations. Which means Ibn Abi Shaybah's narration is correct and authentic as it should be. And the room is open, as time is available for those who wish to call and participate and make or give their opinion. I said that before any call, we take any call, the priority is the opposing scholars. If they want, they can call and speak to Sheikh Al-Habib. Numbers are on the screen. You may call and defend Musa al-Ash'ari. These are very critical and sensitive matters. Muslims found out that you are trying to defend the hypocrite who wanted to assassinate the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him and his messenger. If this was known to Muslims, this is a true disaster for you. Truly, there's no hope for religion that honors those who wanted to assassinate its messenger. You want Muslims to follow those who wanted to kill the messenger of this religion. Why not just call and participate? Why do you run away? From beginning of today's work, from 12 p.m. I called to try to get people to call and discuss this with us, but they ignore me. This is a message to the opposing side. Do not trust these people, these so-called scholars. We have been calling them and contacting them, but they do not want to take part. You should now go and call them and try to pressure them into calling them. And I said to Mawlud al-Sirari, I have a video that will expose your lies and your hypocrisy and your cowardice. We have a call now. May Allah's blessings be upon you this night. I have participation I wish to make, and then you may comment on what I have said. When it comes to the narration of Ibn Musa al-Ash'ari, the Sheikh has shown that you have done your tadlis or your insertion. I don't have anything to add. I'm surprised by something you say. You say that hypocrite then this Islam, the person sometimes he's persecuted, he lives in a place where he's forced to follow the religion, and if he doesn't he will be killed, so he must show his Islam. Was this practiced on Abu Bakr Umar, Abu Muhammad, Abu Muhammad? Whether Abu Bakr Umar was a Muslim in Mecca, and how would they if they're Muslims? We have answered it many times. Sheikh also answered, and the answer is also on Al-Qatr website. Sheikh Habib has shown that hypocrisy happened from the very beginning of the revelation. And the proof is what the Messenger of Allah, the statement himself, when he said, those who want to migrate for a woman, they want to achieve or something in dunya, then they will have it, but not have the afterlife. In the beginning of Islam, they would immigrate for the sake of dunya. This is evidence that there is hypocrisy in Mecca, even at the nascent stage of Islam. Now you call to say, they have showed our tadlis. And I say, yes, show us where this tadlis of fabrication bias happened. Narration. Report the Sheikh has showed. There was a discussion. If you add all the narrations to that, I say here, as a third party, third person, I've heard what the Sheikh has said. He put forward narrations. The conclusion of these narrations, there was an argument between Hudhayfa and Abi, a man from Al Aqaba, those who participated in Al Aqaba's assassination attempt. How did we learn that this man was participant of Al-Aqaba? And this argument happened between two, not three. We've learned by adding narrations together. When we looked at Ibn Abi Shayb's narration, we found that original narration that the narration that Ahmed mentioned, Hudhayfa and another man of hypocrites, when we looked at Musnad Ahmed, we read it, and Ibn Abi Shayba's narration, we learned that the man who was speaking to Hudhayfa was Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. And he was the man who said that. Then the man said, we were told it was Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. And then Sheikh also showed that it was Ahmed ibn Hanbal and your preachers. Practice and a habit to omit the names of the companions if there was narrations that expose them. And to find more proof of that, look at the series of last month of Ramadan. This is the practice of Ahmed. Where is so-called tadlis? Where is this insertion you claim? Well, this is an academic response. Your words are clear. Where is the tadlis? I will comment. First of all, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, we have a narration, confirmed narration is in heaven. In our Sahih is in Jannah or heaven. This narration is not one of them. First, I ask you. I don't allow it. We are not Abu Muhammad. You are not. We are not talking about the narrations that claim Abu Musa al-Ash'ari is good. And we are not attempting here to show that these narrations could have different meanings. Sheikh Habib added all these narrations together and showed that this discussion was between Abu Musa and Hudhayfa. Where was this so-called insertion of tadlis? You have the statements of the scholars of the Salaf. If you want to butcher me, give me what the scholars have said. Before that, you said we did tadlis. We did fabrication. You said some call and expose our fabrication. Where is it? We don't want to just talk ignorantly. I thank Abu Muhammad. He just wants to make accusations, false accusations. Say we fabricate things. It's academic research. Where is the fabrication? He asked some names. He said they expose your fabrication. Where is the fabrication? Where is it? I say by Allah that those who see all these sessions fairly, listen fairly, they said there's a discussion between two people. It is Hudhayfa and Abu Musa. He said, you will butcher me if you bring me, if our ulama or our scholars of the Salaf have said. He did not continue. He said something. Did anyone hear what he said? Perhaps said that our scholars, this is Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. This is wrong. If this is a statement, this is very strange. At any rate, I don't think that you don't consider Hudhayfa is one of the Salaf. He's before even all of them. And he said those things. What if you said our scholar, all scholars, that this narration, Musannaf ibn Abi Shayb, is the same one, it's the same narration of Hadith Muslim, or narration Muslim and Ahmed, we quoted it. Shatri is one of them. He said that is the same narration of Ahmed and Muslim. So if that's the case, then it's the same incident, and there was two people in this argument. So what is this fabrication? Academic research requires us to put narrations together. So if this brother, Allah guide, if he were to look at our sessions from the beginning, he would have learned that when Sheikh Habib departed on this journey to showcase or expose the Muslim Ash'ari, he put all the reports and then he made that conclusion that this discussion is happening between Abi Musa and Hudhayfa. At any rate, we have many calls. We have a call by Muhammad from Syria. Peace be upon you. Go ahead, brother Muhammad. Last session, Ahmed Al-Asa, he spoke for half an hour. I wish you give me the same. With all due respect, brother, with all honesty, those who do not present an academic discussion and research, we will just simply take their answer and pose it to Sheikh Al-Habib. If you have a question, we will see if you deserve to be listened to or not. First, I will begin. And if it had any academic value, I wish I could take more time.
وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه الطيبين الطاهرين وبعد. اللهم إنا نبرأ إليك من حولنا وقوتنا وعلمنا ونلجأ إلى حولك وقوتك وعلمك يا قوي يا عليم. اللهم اهدنا لما اختلف فيه من الحق بإذنك يا كريم.
في البداية يعني as a student of knowledge, I look at everyone. Every student of knowledge has a rank similar in the army. As a student, I do not consider myself someone who represents all Muslims or a sect or a path. All I want is the righteousness of my path. As a student, only represent myself. I want to discuss you on the channel, Sheikh said. My opinion is correct, but could be wrong, and vice versa. And simply attempt to find the truth is sufficient for me. Say, Allah, I attempted this and this is what I could achieve. First of all, what I've been listening to for weeks, a small introduction. Muslim must not be exposed and must be protected. But sometimes there are exceptions. As an Ash'ari or as other jurisprudence texts or other paths, we would not talk about the companions, not because they're infallible, but because the Messenger of Allah just said, do not curse my companions and do not criticize them after me. So, it's good that we mention what some of the women companions said when Jabir said to her, men who criticize companions, even Abu Bakr and Umar, said, why does that surprise you? And they have died, then Allah does not want their blessings to end. So in the beginning, I'm saying, one of the original rules that I'm known, Muslim is not a Muslim if he's not doing so with his own will and power. And so we do not make someone a non-Muslim except with full knowledge. We do not use our assumptions. So it is, must be, so that we have proof, confirmed proof, that person is not a Muslim before making that declaration. But if there is something that's controversial or has room for opinion, and if there's possibility, then it cannot be used as proof. I said to the Sheikh, either he answers me directly or you can relate to him. If we said, I wish him to ask this question. When Allah exalted be said, those who came before, the supporters and those who migrated, Allah's blessings was upon them and they were pleased with him. If we said Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, and if there were no proof that he was a hypocrite that you use and they were no longer accepted, does Abu Musa al-Ash'ari will be those who we can say, oh, may Allah peace be upon him? So now you can listen to the answer of Sheikh al-Habib. Just a small word, brother. As a student of knowledge, I have made 17 refutations, and I'm a student of knowledge. Dear brother, by the way, Sheikh Habib, wants people to discuss with him academically. This brings him joy. First, let Sheikh Habib answer your question. Could you introduce yourself, who you are, where do you come from, what university you studied in? I study Arabic. You're Ash'ari who speaks Arabic. Yes, we have studied this belief. Internet, listen to what Sheikh Habib says. Inshallah, there will be a discussion. Sheikh said, Allah has declared the companions just that Muslim, the original is Muslim cannot, should not be exposed, should be protected. And then he said those narrations, he claimed that the Messenger of Allah has said, and then he went to the topic and he said, a person would not be a Muslim except with full knowledge and power, and also you cannot expel someone from Islam except with full knowledge and complete confirmation. And if this evidence, you said, is no longer true or they have were refuted, does that mean this person become among those who are the Quran has declared as believers? And he wants to say that Quran is confirmed, and he praised the companions. It is not appropriate to expel Abu Musa al-Ash'ari from that group with something that is not 100% confirmed. I just want some introduction, brother, 30 seconds, if you allow me. Introduction, I said about the companions, is for us. The question, Sheikh Habib can answer. I asked a question to Sheikh Habib, and you can hear his answer now. It's as if Sheikh does not want us to comment on this introduction. You say, yes, we respect that. He knows this introduction is not something that we accept. And we have many problems with it. Just quickly, I would say, you could look at our in-depth series known as Kthubat Adalat al-Sahaba. Let him go back, and we have discussed what Sheikh Habib claimed, the narration, the verses, the reports that put people under the illusion that the companions are all just. We will not speak in depth about this false claim by the caller. But a question, to answer the question, say, no, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari does not or is not among those who Allah declared to be just companions of Muhajirin and Ansar, because this verse is general. So It must be confirmed that Abi Musa al-Ash'ari is one of the Sabiqeen, those original believers. And also, the next step would be to determine what Sabq actually meant. Sabq to belief or to declaration of Islam. Because there are people who declared Islam, their Islam, Abdullah ibn Jahsh, for example, or Ubaydullah ibn Jahsh. But despite that, they became apostates, apostatized, and became Christians in Habasha. I want to show, brother, the difference between us, people who follow the path of Ahlul Bayt, and those who follow different paths, Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them. The problem with them is they look at the chronological order. We see it differently. We see it, that Asbaqiyya, or chronological order, refers to belief, and we depend on this for this belief on what Ahlul Bayt has said. When they explained, this verse means those who submitted to the Messenger of Allah in his instruction to follow his Ahlul Bayt and to follow two weighty things. So Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, in all cases, is not part of those who are included in the verse. Same question, but another comment. If Abi Musa al-Ash'ari is no longer part, would he be among those when Allah said, those who came before Muhajirin and Ansar, would it be someone who you say that the proof we said, that proof he's a hypocrite? Even on this assumption, it is not possible, because there is an addition that must be included, that it could mean that he is part of that list that Allah praised, those who followed in good faith. We should see, was he what was for him and against him? Was he among those who followed in good faith as a Muslim, or was someone accused of hypocrisy? In other words, there are no conflicting rules. We must look at each single man of the companions. We leave this point now, and we continue. Let's see that Muslim and Ahmed and Tabaran, and look at Ibn Abi Shayb's narration on the table, what's on it, and then conclusion afterwards. I've heard all the discussions, and I have my problems with them. After I mentioned the narrations, without chain of narration, because you confirmed the chain of transmission of Abi Tufayl, between Hudhayfa and a man who participated in Al-Aqaba, there was an argument. And then he said, how many belonged in Al-Aqaba's attempt, or belonged to the group? Then people said, they were 14. Nabi Musa, Hudhayfa said, if you were among them, there were 15. I testified 12 of them were enemies of Allah and war to Allah and his war, war to Prophet and his Allah, and so on and so forth with the narration. The first point, the conclusion of Sheikh, all the goals he has that he wants to convince us of, or the points he wants to convince us of. Are they something that are possibilities or confront? And if they were, there are possibilities in this narration that confirm Abi Musa of hypocrisy. That is the first. Let Sheikh Al-Habib, so if we do not forget any point you make. Is your assumption as assumption? We see it confirmed because we know how Hudhayfa exposed hypocrisy, and the Shurrah, the commentators on the Sahah and the narration books, have said so. Let me tell you what they have said now, to show you or quote to you what they have said. You see, unfortunately, it takes me time. I'm not very quick. For example, in Takmilat Fath al-Mulhim, said Hudhayf, peace, may Allah be pleased with him, he said, he wanted to share, he was among those who wanted to assassinate the Messenger of Allah, with the way he, and the words he used to indicate that. And another said, Hudhayfa wants to show that he did not doubt, but he wanted to not expose him because he felt pity for him.
In Bahr al-Muhit al-Fajjaj, Sharh Sahih Muslim,
who said, and he said, or used the name of unknown to conceal that, because Hudhayfa, may Allah be pleased with him, he knew full well who the hypocrites were, because the Messenger of Allah told him the names of the hypocrites, and he told him they were 14. So, based on that, even if we were to say they were not irrefutable wording, you say, if you put the method of Hudhayfa with this narration, you would know that was his goal or the reason for his words. What were they, in fact? So that's why this is, for us, is enough evidence.
Sheikh said,
I seem hypocrites, because how Hudhayfa exposed hypocrites. Sheikh said in the past, Umar ibn al-Khattab, when he asked Hudhayfa, am I among the hypocrites? Hudhayfa said, no, and I do not say anyone to you after. When the Sheikh asked, why did you say about what? Hudhayfa did not said because he was afraid of Umar ibn al-Khattab. So now, why did not he have any fear to expose? Why did he fear exposing Abu Musa al-Ash'ari? So to say that is simply because he was afraid. No one was talking about fear. He said he did not reveal it because he had felt pity for him. This is something that you should discuss with your own commentators. It's nothing to do with us. So now I'll continue. Sheikh says that these words are definitive due to all the other things that strengthen it, that make it definitive. Is there another narration, authentic narration, chain of transmission that confirm what Hudhayfa has accused Abu Musa al-Ash'ari with in another narration? Same incident, you mean, or a different incident? No, a different incident. Is there another narration when Hudhayfa testified that Abu Musa was a hypocrite? Yes, exists a narration that Hudhayfa has declared Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Abdullah ibn Musa, is that the one? Yes, this narration. So I will get to it. But now I say, the term, I see it as assumption for three reasons for this narration. First, Hudhayfa is not infallible. Second, he made an indication, not a declaration. And third, with the argument, these three things means that this was not definitive, and it was a possibility because of those three things. First of all, this is a mistake. I don't want you to make this mistake. When you say it is an assumption or it's just a possibility and not definitive, we look at the wording, not the inclinations behind. We look at
وأنك تتكلم عن اللفظ بما هو هو. أما أنك تتكلم عن اللفظ،
but
من الذي
the person who's speaking,
فهذا أجنبي عن
this has nothing to do with the research. Whether
في دلالتي
that term was said or there was doubts, that's a different matter.
وحاصل كلامك
conclusion
على هذه
here
الأمور
is that these three things that you mentioned
حاصلها اتهام
is to accuse حذيفة
أمر ما كان ينبغي
and it's not supposed to happen.
أتقى لله حذيفة عز وجل
is sincere to Allah and he would not accuse or indicate a person is a hypocrite because he was in argument just because he was not infallible. The result is if we said now there are two Muslims
قد اختلفا في دلالة هذا الحديث فمنهم من ذهب إلى اتهام
disagreement on the meaning of this narration. Some would accuse بموسى and some would accuse حذيفة because that's the result of what you say. It's as if حذيفة transgressed to you and accused بموسى الأشياء. So what could a Muslim to do? What is the harm with person who took the side of حذيفة when all the evidence strengthened the side of حذيفة and well, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari is not on the
side.
If it's what people who accuse Abu Hudhayfa and people accuse Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, it becomes opinion. And if it's a possibility, then it's not definitive. So I cannot prove this on my point to you and you as well. I do not accuse Abu Hudhayfa of anything, but saying that he's sincere. It is way too sincere to make that accusation. It's like you saying, isn't infallible that he could not make a mistake. This is what I understand. This is not correct. First of all, if there's a possibility, then there is not definitive. It's not here. But there were two equal opportunities, two equal statements. And all we did was what is stronger. We said our point is stronger. People have heard what you said and have heard what we've said. And I'm surprised you claim that you have not accused Hudhayfa of anything. What you've done is to accuse Hudhayfa of a mistake. Ibn Abdul Barr did that, said, may Allah forgive him. Hudhayfa said something of Abu Musa. I hate it to mention, may Allah forgive him. It simply is saying that Hudhayfa made a mistake. Now we're saying, which is more safe for his person's religion, to side with Hudhayfa, that you have admitted that he was responsible for the hypocrites, that Umar ibn al-Khattab would ask him, by a jury of Allah, am I among the hypocrites? This man who is the guide, is this the person who we should follow, the guide who knows the hypocrites? Or we do say he made a mistake and say, no, he's not infallible. And this was just an argument between him and Abu Musa. So he transgressed and he made that mistake and he must be criticized. Is this safer for your faith? People are hearing you now. And then claiming that what I said is way too sincere. Means that he's infallible has nothing to do with it. When you say someone is sincere to Allah, it means he will not accuse people of misdeeds. Does not mean we are saying he's infallible. They are nothing to do with each other. Pay close attention to the words you're saying. If you claim that to be sincere to Allah, a person must be infallible, and for it not to exist, then it's not infallibility. Then no one can be referred or said to be just or sincere. You must confirm it. No one says that. You must confirm that he's infallible. Infallibility and justice and sincerity that prevents its person from making false accusation, is it something else? What is confirmed between us? Hudhayfa was just, sincere. So he would not accuse or make false accusations of another Muslim. I do not think this as a debate, simply a discussion. I had problems with what Sheikh has said. I don't want to discuss that. I want to save my faith. I have another problem. Another one. Hypocrisy. There's two types. Some exist in the heart, and some that are apparent. It can be described. Those that can describe cannot be make a person disbeliever, like someone who lies or goes back on a promise. But hypocrisy, deep hypocrisy, has certain rules and conditions that the ones who are hypocrites have them. Like when Allah said, they only come to prayer when they're drunk, and they only boast. These things are conditions which confirm hypocrisy. They exist in Abi Musa al-Ash'ari. Well done, brother. You brought up a very important point. And we accept this. So that hypocrisy has many stages. And we accept that. But how can we tell the difference between practical hypocrisy or hypocrisy that is apparent, as we say, someone who is deep in hypocrisy? We look at evidence. Let's say Hudhayfa said of Abi Musa, he has some hypocrisy. We could have looked at it at another lower level of hypocrisy. But if he was talking about people who wanted to assassinate the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him and his family, this no doubt means hypocrisy that exposes a person's true beliefs. Did not answer the question. I asked, did Abi Musa al-Ash'ari have the qualities that Quran said are hypocrisy? Is there a description you want greater than his attempt to assassinate the Messenger of Allah? This betrayal, they are war to Allah and his Messenger. These are the descriptions of hypocrites. We will come back to this idea, but I have a simple question. Some of this description, yeah, what they mentioned, said, yes, that's what I said. Do you want more than this? What is hypocrites' quality or trait? Is that they are a war to Allah and his Messenger? What is more than trying or wanting to kill the Messenger of Allah? This is a war to Allah. This attempt to assassinate the Messenger of Allah. This is the problem we have that we want to discuss. But the question from another aspect. Does Abi Musa al-Ash'ari have some of the hypocrisies that mentioned beside his attempt to kill the Messenger of Allah? Of course there is. But we're not researching this right now. Forgive us, so we don't take too long, because we want to detail it. It looks like the traits of hypocrites that are mentioned in the message. Brother, now if we do that, we're going out of topic. If we stick to the topic, the narration of Hudhayfa. If we go back to narration of Hudhayfa, we speak about another ishkal or problem. It is known that narration that says off and off, from is weak, because it's not declaring it's said to us. Narration in Muslim and Ahmad al-Tabarani, Nabi Shayba, has this problem with it in its essence. Abu Tufayl said, between Hudhayfa and a man who participated in Al-Aqaba, he said there was. Was Abu Tufayl, did he witness the discussion, or was it related to him, whether the chain transmission is correct or not? First of all, when he said what is known, when it says off and off or an of narration is, means the narration is weak, it's not correct. And this rule you claimed is correct, then we could not except Kitab al-Bukhari to be authentic, because he has many of these cases, even Muslim, when he said an or off and off. This only poses a problem and makes the narration from authentic to weak. If there was a possibility that this off and off had a gap, time period gap between them, but what is known that the narrator is narrating of someone who told him the narration, his master, his sheikh, for example, then this is confirmed. The narration is not weak. But saying that, is Abu Tufayl, or did Abu Tufayl witness this argument, or was it related to him? This is against the wording of the narration itself. So, dear brother, because Abu Tufayl is saying, between Hudhayfa and a man, there was an argument. He did not say, I was told, I would reach to me. It is known Abu Tufayl was with Hudhayfa and heard of him, as the scholars of Jarh al-Ta'dil have said. What you've said has no basis on reality. Now another point I want to raise. Narration, you said, between Hudhayfa and a man among them. What happens between people? Which means for us to say Hudhayfa is not infallible, and he could make mistakes or make an accusation, and it could be something based on something he knows. We need to look at the context and to know the rules. And the incident happened between two people who were making an argument. So it could be that Hudhayfa was angry and made that accusation, as what happened Abi Dharr and another companion, when Abu Dharr said, Ibn al-Sawda, when he accused him something of the people of the Jahiliyyah days, when he said that to Bilal, what led Abi Dharr of this was anger. So it could be Hudhayfa, out of anger, made this accusation of hypocrisy. Was this possibility or not? I think we refuted that previously. He said, brother, it is not okay for a person to open the door to many possibilities, because then nothing will stay. No evidence will be accepted anymore or proof. You are saying, because Hudhayfa is not infallible. This is your introduction. So with that introduction, Hudhayfa, not infallible, can make mistakes, say the wrong things because of anger. So we cannot use his words as certain the proof. If you accept your claimed rule, then we will refute all those who did jarh and ta'dil, because they're not infallible. For example, now, how did you know that some of the narrators is weak and his narration is not accepted? You look at the opinions of men who you see as sincere, just, who are experts. So when they accuse someone of weakness or unreliability in narration, we accept it. But because in the first position, they were just people, and they would not accuse someone of something without any proof of an evidence. So you take Ahmed ibn Hanbal's statement when he's criticizing someone, Ahmed ibn Ayn or Mizzi, or Sufyan al-Thawri, or Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani. And you would not accept Hudhayfa's statements, but you accept those individual statements. Those people are not ma'sumin too. They could be angry also, they could also make mistakes, and so on and so forth. In that case, we should just close the door to that science of Jarh and Ta'dil. And there is no narration that criticize someone and accuse him of hypocrisy, and then we will always turn a blind eye to it, because the person could have been angry. And unfortunately, you attributed this to the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him and his family. You say that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him and his family, he insulted people while he was angry, people who were not deserving of insults. And one of them was Muawiyah. And that means he was not a bad person. He said, this narration you fabricate to say, the Messenger of Allah said, I'm a human being, I become angry just like any other human being. Those who insult, I damn. May that be a blessing for him, change to a blessing for him, and so on and so forth. You know this narration. Is this accepted? With all due respect, this is what Shaitan has tricked you with. Because the conclusion of this is to deprive the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him and his family, and those who are just and sincere from everything that they said when they criticize someone and accuse them of something. And the result will become the opposite. And this is nothing but silly. Go ahead, brother. Sheikh said, then we do not take the rules of Jahl and Ta'dil. This is false equivocance, because the incidents of Abi Musa al-Ash'ari and Hudhayfa, that incident, the things that happened, are not the same. And this narration says there was arguments. We have anger, things we do not know of. But those who did Jahl and Ta'dil, it was not due to anger. And Qadi, for example, the judge cannot, the ruling cannot be accepted if he was angry. Hudhayfa made a ruling against Abi Musa al-Ash'ari while he was angry. A simple question. Is it acceptable for Hudhayfa to accuse Abi Musa al-Ash'ari of something? Is it accepted or not? Based on our Sharia laws, or so on and so forth. The brother, a mu'min, while angry, can he kill another mu'min? If he was just, you say. A just, sincere person, would he be just and sincere? We will get to there, point by point. But we say, just believer, sincere person, would contain his anger. He would not let his anger reach to great misdeeds. Then otherwise, he would not become sincere, just believer, a just sincere believer and someone else. When he's angry, he will contain his anger. So, when you're angry, kill a believer, or defile his dignity, or accuse him of such great things. You and your conscience, I say, you accept that Hudhayfa is a believer, just, sincere. On top of that, this person who safeguards the secrets of the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, and his family. All these traits belong to him. And then your conscience tells you he would accuse a believer of wanting to kill the Messenger of Allah. This is not a sensible thing. This is an insult to say our master Hudhayfa. He is not our master. Yes, of course, he is not infallible. But he's just. If you're just, if you're sincere, he will stop at certain place. He would not overstep it. So we cannot accept what you're saying. Then what you're saying are possibilities, brother. That does not conflict with those who look at the narration and its appearance and accept it. I say I dissociate to Allah from Abu Musa al-Ash'ari because of this narration. I believe Hudhayfa is too sincere to Allah to accuse a Muslim of anything. Nothing is confirmed in our religion. If we want to doubt it, we can always make possibilities. Every possibility we can bring. So no stone will be left untouched. We don't want you to fall down that path. When he said, Hudhayfa said, so Abu Dhar said to Bilal, Ibn al-Sawda, the son of the black woman, Abu Dhar was believer and sincere, and he said something to Bilal. That is an insult. So why do we not say anything about Hudhayfa? This was a mistake by him. Is this acceptable or not? Do you look at these two cases to be the same? Are they the same? If Abu Dhar were to become angry and insult Ammar and say to him, the son of the black woman, something that he's like, our lady Sumayya, blessings of Allah be upon her, was black woman. This discussion between two people, something, he wants, Hudhayfa wants to expose another, and he said, he is among those who wanted to kill the Messenger of Allah and Al-Aqaba. This is not the same. The most, that was an insult. If we accept hypothetically that this narration actually, this incident took place, this is an insult that he did, and then, and he repented, according to some narrations. He put his cheek on the soil in repentance. He paid attention to what he said. He wrote this, the mistake he's done. But then we could discuss it and then said, if you're among them, or 15, and so on and so forth, and accuse him of such a critical, sensitive thing. But at any rate, how are these two things are the same? One is an evidence that was wrong, not because of the reality of it, but because it came out of his tongue to insult the other man. But this is no proof. This, what did the man want? This, what did Hudhayfa? Hudhayfa did not want to insult Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. Your own Sharrah said he wanted to expose him being as those who participated in Al-Aqaba. This is not the same thing. False equivocance. Sheikh, or an indication, Sheikh. Hudhayfa, when he accused Abu Musa al-Ash'ari of something, he was angry. Why did appearance of Abu Musa al-Ash'ari in another place and when he was not angry, that shows that this accusation was out of anger. Is there another incident that did not happen out of anger? Brother, we said, a believer, even when he's angry, he would not do great sins. To those who accuse a mu'min of something is like killing him. It's not permitted to go that far. How come, then how about accusing someone of wanting to kill the Messenger of Allah, even if we assume that he was angry? Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him and his family. This is the difference between us and your sect. We say the Prophet, even when he is angry, he would only say the truth. If you curse someone, damn someone, what he said was not out of anger. How dare you to accuse the Messenger of Allah to make these mistakes when he was angry and accuse people of things that they are innocent of? No, we exonerate the Messenger of Allah. We defend them against this. And the Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them, who were just according to all sects, from his family and his companions. Hudhayfa is one of them, one of those select few. As you've also indicated in our discussion, there are other incidents, and another, at least one incident, where Hudhayfa declared Abu Musa al-Ash'ari a hypocrite when he was not angry. It was not an argument. This narration said one of them was a hypocrite, him and Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. There is no indication here that he was angry. I did not want to speak about the other narration until the end, but since it was mentioned, there's a problem with this narration. Hudhayfa, Allah be pleased with him, He was in a gathering. Then Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and Abu Musa al-Ash'ari entered this gathering. Then Hudhayfa said, one of them is a hypocrite. Then he said, Hudhayfa, Abdullah is the closest person in voice and behavior to Messenger of Allah. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari is known as Abu Abdullah, and the other person is also known as Abdullah. Now there's a problem. Both men are Abdullah. So, possibility of this narration is that Hudhayfa wanted to talk about a man among one of them, but then he realized, and then he met name of the man. So these people, then he exit out of it in a wise way. Dear brother, you made us laugh. Thank you. We did not think anyone to make any statement. We make your statement for people to judge. This girl was weak. It's good you know it was weak. May Allah bless you. May Allah forgive you. Brother Muhammad, may Allah bless you. If you conclude, because we are at the end of the session. I will conclude quickly. Problem, I said, none of those who called have made this argument. The statement of the narration, and three were excused. Is Abu Musa al-Ash'ari one of those who were excused or not? And what is the evidence? What proof do you have? No doubt he was not among them. Why? Because of the beginning of the narration, between him and someone of those who participate in Al-Aqaba, and it appears to be that this man was the person who was accused of this crime. Then also the content of the narration, and then what Shurrah has said, who said Hudhayfa wanted to expose this man to be a hypocrite. So no doubt he was not. And otherwise, then Hudhayfa's words would not have had any meaning. If we said, assume Abu Musa al-Ash'ari participate in Al-Aqaba, 15 men, and we said he's part of them, and asked if he is among those who were excused or not, is there evidence that he's excused, or there's evidence that he was not excused? Is there proof or not? As I said, the wording of the hadith and its context was trying to expose him, so he was not. Then if he was, then Hudhayfa would have no reason to accuse him of anything. Narration. Its content confirms that Abu Musa al-Ash'ari was in Al-Aqaba, but he does not show that he was which group. It confirms that he was not among the group that were excused. That is the content, the context of the notion. Why did he embarrass him? Say, how many were they? Why did he want to embarrass him with that? For what reason? There is an argument between two. Why did you want to confirm his existence? He wants to prove he was among those who went to kill the Messenger of Allah. So he's not excused. That is the purpose of Hudhayfa's words. And Shurrah himself has said that. Then Hudhayfa's words were meaningless, pointless. Hudhayfa wanted to confirm Abu Musa al-Ash'ari among those 15. The narration doesn't say that he was among those who wanted to kill the Messenger of Allah. So Abu Musa al-Ash'ari would remain among those who wanted to kill the Messenger of Allah or among those who were excused. Correct. The words are correct. The narration doesn't specify. But it goes against the context of narration and the purpose of Hudhayfa that is known. What did Hudhayfa want? What was the scroll? Why did he want to embarrass that other side with? I told you what the Shurah said. He wanted to expose him as being among those who wanted to assassinate the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him and his family. Otherwise, his words would have been dribbled. Why would he embarrass someone who is excused? What is the embarrassment that will cause to another person? And also, you don't have, I have the context. And I have what the Shurah have said. What is common sense to anyone who reads this narration? What do you have evidence that shows that Abi Musa was excused? So our point is stronger. This is an understanding, not proof. Understanding includes proof and evidence. Understanding of something includes evidence and proof. Context is to you. Hujjah or evidence or not. We could have two different meanings. Yes, we could have a different understanding. I use context in my defense. You do not. So I have a stronger point. So my statement is stronger at any rate. Even if you do not accept my understanding. Dear brother, may Allah bless you. And with all honesty, it's a good discussion and enjoyable. May Allah bless you. Another one. This one last. Go ahead, dear brother. Another Sheikh has answered another point I would raise. He answered it, but I want Sheikh to answer it again. So, because I want to have a problem with the answer specifically. He mentioned those who made this argument. He said, why did the Messenger of Allah appoint Abi Musa al-Ash'ari after all he's done? Give him roles after all he's done. Sheikh said, it is an infallible will permitted for him and his successors to appoint hypocrites. Is that correct? Then yes, that is correct. If we said, Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him and his family, appointed Abi Musa al-Ash'ari, gave him a certain role with Mu'adh to lead Yemen, govern Yemen. That was on Hajjat al-Wada'ir. After the incident of Al-Aqaba. And it is known that time that people, governors, were teachers of Quran and jurisprudence and prayer, and they judged between people. So could the Messenger of Allah appoint a hypocrite in Yemen to teach people their faith and to for them to follow him in prayer and learn the rules of their faith from? Well done, brother. We say yes. It is reasonable to do that, and I ask you by Allah. I say this logically, even common sense, if we could say. Have you not heard or known some presidents, when they see they're hypocrites or those who they fear they will commit a coup, they would put them very far places, like make them ambassadors in far-flung countries or some. Is this happening or not? There's a time difference. I'm not talking about now. I said no, based on wisdom. We say, does wisdom dictate? Does wisdom dictate sometimes this thing to happen? Time does not have no role to play in this. It's still wisdom. This is a wise action. Do you accept that or no? I do not. Because the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him and his family, would not send someone hypocrite to teach Quran and prayer and rules. So, thank you. Now, first of all, we say the act itself can be wise, logically, The Prophet, peace be upon his family, would keep a distance between him and hypocrites, even by appointing them or giving them roles. Is this logical or not? I talk about narrations, not logic. I try with both sides, brother. I will talk to you about narrations. I see, because what I've seen. I bring it to you later. But I see, because I see you're a sensible person. You do not deny that logic sometimes, or wisdom sometimes, dictates. He said, wisdom can dictate that. He said, yes, wisdom does dictate sometimes this happening. He said, yes, we do not have narration. A single narration that states that it is not permitted to appoint a hypocrite to any role or give him any role. But narrations, in fact, on the contrary, they show that it's hypocrites sometimes are given these roles. The Messenger of Allah said, what allows this nation to my nation to stand firm are its hypocrites. Another term says those who lead this nation are its most evil. Umar also said, we depend on the hypocrite, and he's guilty of his own sins. Well, do not forget, Musa is not the first or the last that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him and his family, that gave them roles and instructions, but they apostatized afterwards. Now, we're not talking about Umar. We're talking about the Prophet, peace be upon his family. Was there not enough companions that he would appoint Abu Musa al-Ash'ari? Well, he's a hypocrite to teach people Quran, narration. Brother, this is out of place. It's like saying, did the Messenger of Allah get so much harm from the companions that he could not find someone to write revelations except Quraiz, who later apostatized? Why did he depend on this person? We shouldn't go that far and try to involve ourselves so much with the policies of the Messenger of Allah. The Prophet knows his duty. When he appoints a hypocrite or gives them certain roles, because it's wisdom. Wisdom dictates it. The narration that is authentic and accepts is acceptable to us. Said that Allah will strengthen his faith with a corrupt man. You don't have evidence. You say, is it logical? Why did I begin my refutation with logical statement? But then you admit it. You said, no, logically, it is possible. It is possible. What is remaining is reports of history. You do not have historical proof that shows it is not permitted. Let's say that the Prophet say, I will only appoint just people. The evidence goes the other way, actually. Thank you, Muhammad. I apologize for interrupting you. You may call later, actually, tonight or later nights. Can I just finish though with 1 minute? You may, but at the end of the session, if we had time, we can't. I have no problem. What do we say as an answer? How do we answer? Say, narrations of the scholars have mentioned the name of the 15 hypocrites that participated in Al-Aqaba and mentioned the reasons of the hypocrisy and their acts of hypocrisy, and did not put Abu Musa among them. These narrations are not as strong as the ones we have, because these narrations are weak. Among them is Al-Waqidi, someone who is weak in your own sources. But if we have confirmed with authentic narrations and many that the hypocrites 15 they were mentioned by name and they do not exist, if we assume that first there is no authentic narration, if there was, then we look at the possibilities, which is stronger, which is where, which have more assonance, stronger. If you have them, present them. If they're confirmed, as I said to you, if there are two opposing sides cannot be added together, then we would look at which side is stronger. Or, as to say, some of your opposers said there were two incidents of Al-Aqaba happened, two groups that wanted to assassinate the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him and his family. I thank Brother Muhammad from Syria. Before, if you could give us your full name. Could you give us your full name? Do not like answers that this answer would be either boasting or lies. I think I know you, but I don't. I'm not sure. At any rate, it's the first time. The first time I participate. It's probably someone else. I thank you, brother. And this good discussion you've had, and I thank you for sticking to the topic, and we accept what you've done and your manners and your ability to hear. This is what we want the opposers to be like. And I also ask you to speak to those we studied under, to come this to debate Sheikh Habib. And as you see, we did not give you enough time. I did not even interrupt you. Just between you and Sheikh Habib. This is what we want. This is what we want. And Allah knows we are fair in this. So if you know someone acceptable that can debate Sheikh Habib, someone who has good manners and ethics, as you've seen, this will benefit this nation. May Allah intensify your words. Thank you. And I thank you, Sheikh Habib. I thank the Sheikh. I thank this brother. It was another brother we promised. Brother Kareem. We tried to contact him. I said, I am tired. Perhaps tomorrow. Then. These are the examples that we want. This is also the opposers, the so-called Sunni, must not be so confrontational, angry, and clowning, you know. Don't follow these ways. I say, make the opposers, especially the opposers, scholars and preachers, learn from these individuals. Someone's calm, respectable, everyone who can benefit from, also Brother Kareem. This is how discussions happen. Something that we can get benefit of. And of course, Sheikh, with these kind of discussions, proof comes out. So this brother submits. If he doesn't have blind following, when he says his refutation has a problem, he just moves on. It's good. This is fairness. Let us learn from each other. We are not here in a fighting ring. We must learn from each other. We are in disagreement. Muslims are in disagreement. We disagree upon certain persons, Abu Bakr, Umar, Aisha, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, so on and so forth. Should we fight each other over it? You have an opinion, and I have an opinion. Allah willing, you become Shia, and we all follow Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them, and their love. And if we do not agree with each other, we excuse each other, and we continue going forward. It's not necessary for us to fall into this extremist behavior and to shout at each other and fight each other. It shouldn't reach that level. Islam is much higher than these characters. The center of Islam, this foundation of Islam, is Muhammad and his family, pure family, peace be upon them. Everyone else is up to discussion. I thank those listening, and also repeat my call to the opposers, scholars, to debate Sheikh Al-Habib and discuss this matter of Sheikh Al-Habib, and we will give them room as long as there's someone who are accepted, or at least someone like this brother who knows how to have a discussion. We will allow them and give them enough room. May Allah bless him. May Allah's blessings and peace be upon Muhammad and his pure family, and his damnations upon their enemies and those who murdered them.
بارك الله بكم.